All right, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 18.
Good morning, sir.
Let me just pause for 1 second. Okay, so yesterday's lecture was a review of all the things that we have covered so far, right? And so is there still difficulty in understanding what is going on here? Have you all attempted these problems or try to, you know, solve this, just work through my steps? Bharti? Bharti is here? Bharti is not here. Theek hai? Okay. All right, so in fact, let's just take a look at our course plan. Right. So we've talked about all of this, right? I think superposition, right? Human unitary operators, etc., etc. So what is left, right? Well, what comes next? Well, one of the things is Schrodinger and Heisenberg representation, and then there's a third representation which is called the interaction representation. And then we haven't really talked about entanglement. I'll talk about that in more detail when I come to composite systems, but I would like to introduce it, the basic idea here. I have introduced the basic idea in earlier classes. Then of course you have to look at some problems, right? So we've already looked at Schrodinger equation for a free particle and particle in infinite potential well. Then we have to see, well, what happens if your potential well is finite, right? So in that case, what happens is that your eigenvalue equation cannot be solved exactly analytically. You have to solve it numerically. There is a graphical method to solve it. And then, so in one dimension, you have another, so you can have all kinds of potentials, right? You can have attractive potentials. Like attractive means that it would be like a well, right? That's something which would trap the particle, or it could be like a hill, right? It could be something that rises up and goes down, right? So it becomes like a potential barrier. So what happens is that you can send in a particle, let's say, right, a plane wave, which comes into the potential barrier, and ask what happens. How does the wave interact with the barrier? So then what you find from solving Schrodinger's equation is that the wave, even though there is no wave on, there's a wave on one side, but there's no wave on the other side, right? Because you have sent in a wave from here. You find that you will end up with some probability of finding the particle on the other side of the barrier, even though there was nothing to begin with. So this is known as the concept of tunneling. Right? It's a very important concept because it explains the phenomenon of beta decay. Beta decay is the process in which inside a nucleus, a neutron decays, converting into a proton, an electron, and a gamma ray. And so the electron shoots out of the nucleus, and the atomic number of the particle increases by one because the proton has been created, and the gamma ray and the electron shoot out of the nucleus. So there the question becomes that how does the electron manage to escape from the nucleus? Because it's a negatively charged particle, and the nucleus consists of all of these positively charged particles. Generally, these are heavy nuclei. So you would have atomic number 30 and forwards. So how does the electron escape from the pull of 30 protons, right? And the explanation for that lies in this phenomenon of quantum tunneling. So the attractive potential of these protons behaves like a barrier, which is preventing the electron from escaping, right? So that is what we will be talking about next. Then we'll consider the harmonic oscillator. That is one of the most important problems in quantum mechanics, in physics. The concept of, there is Dirac's procedure of solving the Hamiltonian of the harmonic oscillator, which leads you to these creation annihilation operators. Then we'll talk about angular momentum and the algebra of angular momentum. And then understand how to work with spin 1/2 systems. So these are very important, right, for condensed matter, for many body physics, for quantum computation, and so on. And then finally, we'll talk about composite systems. What happens when you exchange identical particles, right? You get fermions, bosons, and also anions. In two dimensions, you get anions. And there's a concept of density matrices, which is very important. Okay, so this is the plan going forward. So let me, I'll begin by talking about what the Schrodinger and the Heisenberg representation, okay? And again, if you have any questions, please unmute yourself and ask at any point.
Sir, you have taken a quiz, and most of them I have not well performed on that. So, can you please again retest, because it's 10% weightage, I think, in your course.
Huh? Sorry?
The quiz weightage is actually 10%, sir, as shown in your course plan. So, may you please organize again a test?
Acha, Ashutosh, can I show you the test result? Let me share the test results with all of you, okay? Since you are saying that most people have not scored well, so you don't have the statistics, right? So let's look at the statistics, okay? Theek hai na? I can't reconduct the quiz, because in order to improve the scores of a few people, right? Okay, so these are the results, right? So let's see, seven people got above 8, one person got between 9 and 9.5. Now, yeah, there were a lot of people who didn't get such great marks, but the thing is that to what extent can that be blamed on, not submitting your answers? Maybe that can be blamed in like 4 or 5 cases, right? But not every one of you can claim that you didn't get a good score because you didn't read the instructions properly, right? I mean,
so that was the problem of instructions.
So that was a problem for you, na, Ashutosh?
Yes, sir.
Right. So because it was a problem for you, like, why should I conduct a quiz for everybody again? How does that make any sense? How does it make any sense for those 10, 11 people who have already got good scores? I mean, is this your basic justification that because something doesn't go well with you, everybody else should also be made to experience the test again? I don't know what kind of thinking that is.
Okay.
All right, so we'll be talking about the Schrodinger versus the Heisenberg representation. And what are they? What? So the Schrodinger representation don't you have the thing? But there are five questions. The answers to those questions that are really trivial. What do you want to review? क्या review करने के लिए बताइए? एक question में typo था जो square root of 2 है. That's it.
नहीं मतलब सर क्वेश्चन सारे हो गए थे पर जो पता नहीं चल रहा कि कहाँ मार्क्स कट गए. मतलब एक दो नंबर जो कटे हैं वो कहाँ कटे हैं पता ही नहीं चल रहा. Like we can see our marks but if you can sir it's
भाई मैं देखता हूँ. देखिए इतना मत आप लोग टेंशन लीजिए क्विज की वजह से, ठीक है ना? आप लोग इसलिए टेंशन ले रहे हैं. यू आर टेकिंग टेंशन बिकॉज योर मार्क्स हैव बीन कट, नॉट बिकॉज यू हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड समथिंग. एंड दैट इज कंप्लीटली द रॉन्ग पर्सपेक्टिव, राइट? ओके.
यस,
इट्स कंप्लीटली द रॉन्ग पर्सपेक्टिव. सो इफ यू डोंट understand how to solve any of the problems, you tell me that. I'll cover that in class. We'll go over that.
Excuse me, sir. About that checking, like I want to see like what did I do wrong, na? इसीलिए पूछ रहा हूँ. देखना तो पड़ेगा ना कि गलती क्या हुई है, या फिर मेरा method सही था या गलत था. इसी के लिए तो
method क्या है? Multiple choice में क्या method होता है?
नहीं, in the sense of like what did I do wrong? गलती तो देखनी पड़ेगी ना सर. देख रहा हूँ एक सेकेंड. I'm having some difficulty in one second, okay?
Right, got it. Okay. There's a preview link. I couldn't find that. Okay, I got it. Preview. All right, so let's talk about the quiz instead, right? Okay. So we have the first question, let's say number one. Psi is equal to root 3 by 5, 0 plus b1. Okay. What are the possible allowed values of b, right? If psi is a normalized state. So what are the allowed values of the coefficient b? Right, if psi is normalized, what does that mean? That this is one, right? So what is this? This is 3 by 5 plus b square, right? This is equal to 1. So b square is what? 2 by 5. Right? So what are the allowed values of b? Right? B can be root 2 by 5, right? This was the one that had a typo. It can be I by root 2 by 5. Yes? It can also be minus I root 2 by 5. Right? It can also be minus root 2 by 5. All of these options are allowed, right? Yes?
Yes, sir.
So you have to...
Sir, iota into root 2 by 5 power, sir. I square will be minus b square b square.
Bhai, b square ka matlab kya hai?
Okay.
Okay, I understand. What is this? This is the amplitude, no? For a complex number. If you have a complex number, z is equal to r e to the I theta. Is per se likh sakte hain, right? This is one parameterization of a complex number. So what is z square? It's r square, no? Here r is r and theta are real numbers. This is the phase, this is the magnitude. Okay. Any issues? Any issues? Any questions? Any doubts about this? Okay. Next question is, you have some operator, right? And these are all complex numbers. So again, if O is unitary, what is the condition for unitarity? Right? The adjoint, Hermitian adjoint should be equal to the inverse of O. And what's the inverse of O? Well, the inverse of this matrix is equal to 1 over the determinant AD minus BC, right? And then DA minus B minus C, right? This is O inverse. Okay. But this is not a condition, right? So this is one of the options. But obviously, this is not a condition. This is just a statement that the definition of what is the definition of O inverse, right? This doesn't tell us anything. Then there's another option, O, right? Obviously, this is not the one. Then O inverse is equal to O transpose. This is also not the one because this is the Hermitian adjoint, complex transpose, right? So what is the Hermitian adjoint? Dagger, complex transpose. So you have to take the complex conjugate and the transpose, right? So this is the Hermitian adjoint. So one second. Yes, and this has to be equal to O inverse. So this is the correct condition answer. Is this fine? So far, I've not heard any objection.
Why first one is wrong? Like O inverse. Like why that general case is wrong?
What this?
Yes, sir.
But this is just the definition of what the inverse of the matrix is, no? The condition is this, na?
Yes.
This is just the definition, na? This is just a definition of what is the meaning of O inverse. This doesn't tell me that O inverse is actually equal to O adjoint.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Huh.
So I marked the just that O dagger O equal to I, and it shows your answer is partly correct.
Which one?
This first one, sir. I just marked the first one. A dagger, A equal to I.
Oh,
but
this
my
one.
Review showed, yes, sir. No, sir. First one. First
this one.
No, sir. Upper one. The unit.
Oh, sorry. Oh, sorry. One second. Ah, yes, yes. Right. So look at the wording of the question, right? If O is unitary, then what are the correct possible expressions for its inverse? Huh. So this is also a correct possible expression. And this is also a correct possible expression. Okay. Both of these are correct expressions for O inverse, right?
So does this inverse works for complex numbers too?
Of course it works for complex numbers. Why would it not work for complex numbers?
I just thought like it. Huh? Okay, thank you, sir.
Oh, yeah. Then third question. O is again some operator. And which of the following operators are Hermitian, right? Constructed from O. So what does it mean to be Hermitian? Hermitian operator is Hermitian when A dagger is equal to A, right? Now what do we have? We have O dagger plus O inverse, right? So what we should do is we should take the Hermitian conjugate of this operator. If we take the Hermitian conjugate, what do we get? We get O Hermitian conjugate, which is O again, right? And then O inverse, this thing, Hermitian conjugate. Now, this is not the same as what we started with, no? So this is not Hermitian. Then you have O, O dagger. So if I take the Hermitian conjugate of this, right? So if you have two matrices, you take the transpose, what is that? B transpose, A transpose, right? So this will give you O dagger, dagger, and O dagger, right? So this will give you O, O dagger. Right, so this is Hermitian. O plus O dagger, this is Hermitian. Right? And then finally, O plus O inverse, this will not be Hermitian. Right? In general. Right? In general, this will not be Hermitian. For some particular operator, you know, that might be the case, but not in general. Fine. So these are the two options. O dagger and O plus O dagger. Any questions? Number four. A system is described by a three-dimensional Hilbert vector space, right? So your basis vectors are 0, 1, and 2, right? And the given vector is 1 by root 3, 0, 1 by root 3, 1, 1 by root 3, 2, right? And then you have another vector phi, one by root three zero minus one by root three, right? So the only difference between these two is here in the sign in this third term, right? So what is the value of pi square minus pi square? What is it going to be? Zero. Yes? No?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What? Yes, sir.
Simple enough. Right? Because the sign will not matter. It will drop out of the expression. Right. So you see, I asked these very simple questions. I could have asked you something like, normalize this wave function for the free particle or the, all of those problems you could have sat down and solved, no? Because you've all taken JE advanced and everything. That's what you know how to do. Right, but these are the very basic, simplest question. Right, this is what you need to be able to do. You need to understand in order to be able to do quantum mechanics successfully. Right. So, what is the value of imaginary part of the inner product of these two? Right. So what is this is the ket vector, what is the bra vector? Bra vector will be, what will happen to this component? This will become minus 2.4i, right? Because you have to take the complex conjugate, zero. This one will, the coefficient will not change, right? Now when you take the inner product of this with this, what will you get? You'll get minus 2.4i times 9, right? And then 8.4 times 2.4, right? So what is the imaginary part here? The imaginary part is, once again, 8.4 times 2.4i, sorry, right? So this is going to be 8.4 minus 9i. You can work it out, right? This is the number, whatever it is, minus 0.6. 2.4 times 6. Right? So this is going to be equal to minus 14.4i. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I'll go ahead and turn on the review option, okay? So that you can go and review your answers also. because it's possible that there is some error in the setup of the quiz at some point. But does this like answer, does this satisfy like your desire to understand what is going on in each question?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and I've turned on the review. You can go and review also. Anything else in this regard? Or can we close this matter and move on? Bataiye, I'm waiting for a response. If you're not satisfied in any way, you tell me now so I can address whatever your concerns are. Now, you might not be satisfied with the results of the quiz, but when I say satisfied, are you satisfied with? Well, okay, never mind. If you're not satisfied, you're not satisfying. Nothing can be done about that. Okay, so let me talk about Schrodinger and Heisenberg representation. Okay, so what is the Schrodinger representation? Well, the Schrodinger representation is the one that we have been using all along. So in the Schrodinger representation, what we say is that states are functions of time. They depend on time, right? So as time ticks, the clock ticks, the state changes, right? So this is an active perspective, right? Remember, you have the active and the passive viewpoint, right? This is the Schrodinger representation. But in this perspective, what about operators? Like for instance, the Hamiltonian, right? The Hamiltonian or the momentum operator or the position operator, any other operators. These are unchanged. Okay, these are constants. The form of these operators does not depend on time. So when we say constant in time, that does not mean that the expectation values of these operators are constant in time. It means the form of the operators is constant in time. So one can take the other perspective also, right? That's called the Heisenberg representation, which is that okay, so in the Heisenberg representation, our operators become functions of time. Whereas our states, these remain unchanged. Right? So you can think of this as your passive viewpoint. These are unchanged. Okay. Now you might ask that if my state is unchanged, how is my system evolving? Right. So the evolution of the system is captured by the change in the operators. Right. Because ultimately, what matters? What are the what is the physical output, right? What are the physical consequences? It is the things you measure, expectation values, right? So you measure, let's say, the expectation value of H, the Hamiltonian, the energy. So if you evaluate this in the Schrodinger representation, at a certain time t, it will look like this, right? This is in the Schrodinger representation. If you evaluate the same thing in the Heisenberg representation, what do you get? Okay, can you all hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, got disconnected for a little bit. Right? So this is the Heisenberg representation. Calculation for the exact same thing. So these two will give you the same result. Right? So then what is the point of having these two different expressions, these two different ways of doing things? Well, it helps in certain situations, right? It always helps to have more than one way to state a problem, right? So these are two different ways to state the same problem. And then there's a third, something that is midway between them, which is called the interaction representation. So we'll talk about that at a later stage. Okay. Now, in order to understand these different representations, what's going on, what we first have to understand is what is going on in the process of time evolution. In general, right? We haven't really discussed this so far. So the time evolution of a quantum state is described by the Schrodinger equation, right? So this is the Schrodinger equation. Okay, you have a Hamiltonian, you have some state, and this is the time derivative of the state. Now, how can you solve this? Right, this is a differential equation. Can we solve this differential equation? Right. So what we can do is we can work in some particular basis. Right. So we can work in the position representation, let's say, or, you know, so in other words, we can work with the components of psi. Whatever psi is, remember, for instance, if psi is some particle on a line, this will be the representation of the state, right? This is a particle in one dimension. Or psi could be something like this. Right? This could be a spin 1/2 system, a qubit, right? And then you can have other different types of expressions, but they all look the same basically, because, right, you have some coefficient and you have some basis vectors, right? That's what psi is, right? So this expression, the Schrodinger equation, can be translated into an equation for these coefficients, right? So you can write it as, in this case, for example, you can write it as the Hamiltonian acting on psi of x is equal to I h bar d by dt psi of x, okay? Now this becomes an ordinary differential equation, right? So how can I solve this? Well, first let me write down the solution for you, okay? And then we'll work backwards from that and see whether that's the correct expression. So psi of xt, right, is equal to exponent minus I by h bar integral of ht prime dt prime from t is equal to zero to this value of t, whatever this value of t was, times psi xt. Okay, so this is what I'm claiming is the solution of this expression. Okay. And here I'm taking into account the fact that it is possible that H could also have some time dependence. Right? So if I for the moment, if I just consider a time independent Hamiltonian, right, and what kind of a system would have what would be a time dependent Hamiltonian? For example, if you consider an electron, let's say, or an atom, and you apply some external perturbation, like you apply RF wave or a microwave or something, right? So your Hamiltonian could be of this form, for instance. Your kinetic energy, your potential energy, right? And then it could be something like this. This is a periodic perturbation, right? This is caused due to some external influence. Could be an external electromagnetic wave or something else, right? So this is time dependent, right? So for the time being, let's just consider a time independent Hamiltonian. And ask what is the solution of the equation in that case, of the Schrodinger equation. So the solution can be written in this way: minus I by h bar t h psi x, not like this. Okay. Why is this? Because if you look at this integral over here, right, if h is a constant, then this integral just becomes ht, right? So the claim is that this is a solution of this Schrodinger equation, right? So how can I check that? I can check that by taking the time derivative of this expression, right? So if I take the time derivative, let's see what I get. So let me take the time derivative of this psi. Right? So the time derivative will be the time derivative of this exponent psi x naught, right? This doesn't depend on time. Okay? Now, what is this expression? This is d by dt of exponent something like t times a, right? So in your exponent, you have the time and some operator, right? So what is the time derivative of this? It is t times it's going to be equal to a, right? This a will come down, we get e times Okay. If you are not convinced that this is the case, you can use the exponential expansion, right? The series expansion. What is the series expansion of the exponent, exponential function? Right? Then you can take the derivative of each term. So we need to take d by dt of eta. What do you get? You get zero, right? This is just the identity. What do you get here? Here you get a. Here, what do you get? You get 2t a square by 2, right? D by D, right? And then so on. So let me write down the next term also, because that will help. Ta cubed by 3 factorial. So the next one will be 3t square a cubed by 3 factorial, right? Now, this expression can be written as, what can I do? I can take out a factor of a from each term, right? If I take out a factor of a, what happens? This term becomes identity times a. The second term becomes, right, ta. And what happens to the 2? This cancels. Here, what do I get in this expression? I get t square a square. And what happens here? This 3 and 3 factorial. I'm left with 2 factorial, right? So what will this series sum up to? This series will sum up to precisely exponent of t times a, right? And so that tells me that my time derivative of this ta is equal to a times t, right? Okay, I'll stop here since you all have a class. I suppose you have a class, right? Yes? No? Do you have a class now?
9:45.
9:45, okay, then I'll continue for 5 more minutes, okay? So this is the time derivative of this expression. Now you might ask that this is an operator, right? These are all operators. So why don't I write this as e to ta times a? Can I write this expression in this way? Are these two expressions equivalent? Does it matter whether I put the a in front or in the back? Can somebody tell me? Priya, are these two expressions equivalent?
Sir, since a is operator, its order matters. Sir, a is operator, then its order matters, but...
its order matters, right?
Yeah.
But in this case, does the order matter? In this particular case, does the order matter? Right? And the answer is no. It doesn't matter. Why is that?
Sir, but it depends on
the potential can be expressed in the form of Taylor series.
Huh? Panchami, yes?
Would it not depend on the function that we're operating it on, sir?
what if we take an exponential
right. Yes, sir. Panchami, one second guys, Panchami was saying something that I missed.
Yeah, because the exponential function can be expressed in form of Taylor series of A, and A commutes with itself, or any power
exactly.
of
exactly exactly A commutes with matter? itself. A commutes with itself. So this means that A also commutes with any power of itself, right? Yes. So if A commutes with any power of itself, that means A commutes with this exponential function also. Or it commutes with any function of A in general, like this. So whether I write A times FA or F of A times A, these are equivalent to each other. Okay? So I again, if you're not convinced, you should sit down and work out this series expression. Okay? This is something that you should have understood properly. So if I work out the time derivative, if you come back to this expression now, right? So what do I get over here? I get minus I h bar h, right? This will come out of the exponent. Times this exponent minus I by h p h power psi epsilon, right? Now in this expression, this part, what is this part? By this part is just psi of xt, right? That's what I've said is psi of xt, right? And I should put all of this within brackets, right? So what do I have finally? I have d by dt psi of xt is equal to minus ia over h bar Hamiltonian psi of xt, right? Now I just a simple matter of taking h bar over to the other side, multiplying by I, and what do I get? I get h psi of xt is equal to I h bar d by dt psi of xt, right? So this, and what is this? This is a Schrodinger equation, right? This is the Schrodinger equation. So this solution satisfies the Schrodinger equation, right? So it's a solution. Okay? Now, we can write this in a slightly more general way, like in this way. We can write this same Schrodinger equation, we can write it in this way. Okay. What is this saying? This is saying that the state at some time t prime, where let's say t prime is greater than t, right? The state at some time t prime is related to the state at some time t by some operator, right? And what kind of operator should this be? Right? This has to be a unitary operator, right? Why? Because if it's not a unitary operator, then the norm of psi am I audible? Hello?
Can you hear me?
Okay. So the norm of psi has to be equal to the norm of psi at all times, no? Otherwise, probability is not conserved. So this is true only if U is a unitary operator. Okay. So our time evolution operator, this guy, exponent minus ih bar th. So I can also write it in this way. I can write it as t prime minus t h prime. This is equal to u t prime t. This is my time evolution operator. And it's a unitary operator. You can check that this condition is true. What is the inverse of this operator? The inverse of this operator, right? So I have the exponential of some operator. And ask, what is the inverse of this operator, this whole operator? What is the inverse going to be? Sukhmanpreet, what is the inverse of this, of exponent A?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Sir, your voice was not clear.
I'm saying I have an operator A. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
You have an operator A and I take the exponential of this operator, right?
Yes.
What is the inverse of this exponential?
Don't know, sir.
What is the inverse? If I give e to the x, what is the inverse of e to the x?
E to the power minus x.
Can you take a guess what the inverse of this operator should be?
E power e inverse.
Are? Why a inverse? Did I write this as e to the power minus 1 by x? Right? If you take e to the minus a and multiply by e to the a, what do you get? You get the identity. Right? This is the identity operator. So this is the inverse of this expression. Right? So the inverse of this expression will simply cause a change of sign here. This will just become plus. Okay. What about the Hermitian adjoint? Let me. Just put in a couple more pages. Okay. What about the Hermitian adjoint? What will this be equal to? Ananya?
Yes, sir.
What will this be equal to?
E to the power Hermitian of the operator.
Right. So if I have my this time evolution operator, exponent minus I by h bar, t prime minus t, write it a little bit more clearly. Right? And I ask, what is the Hermitian adjoint of this? Well, the Hermitian adjoint of this will be exponent. And then the Hermitian adjoint of everything in inside this exponent. Now, this is a real number, t, the t prime minus t. H bar is a real number. When I take the Hermitian adjoint, I will become plus I. Right? What will happen to H? Well, H is an operator, so I have to take the Hermitian adjoint of H. Right? What is the Hermitian adjoint of H equal to? Remember, H is a Hamiltonian. So what should a Hamiltonian, what kind of an operator should a Hamiltonian be? Harsh?
Yes, sir. Hermitian operator, sir.
Hermitian operator. So this should be equal to H. Right? So the Hermitian adjoint of this operator is equal to exponent I H bar T prime minus T H. And this is also equal to the inverse of that operator, right? Because that's what I just explained to you, right? The inverse is just changes the sign of the exponent. Right? Which tells me that U is unitary. One thing which I guess I have not explicitly worked out in class is this statement, and I leave this for you as an exercise. And I would suggest that you solve this exercise because I can ask something like this on the midterm also. Okay? All right, I'll stop here because you might have breakfast or some other things to do. Okay? Any questions? Okay, I'll stop the recording then.